I wanna be close to you. I wanna be close to you. There's nothing in this world that compares to all you are. In the arms of the Father, there is love like no other. He who formed all things offers love to me. And where you go, we will follow. Through the dark, through the narrow, and in all.
Free concert. Invite all your friends. You have a handout in your bulletin. Invite all your friends to come, and we will take a generous love offering at the end of the concert to help compensate them for coming. But we're very, very excited about this event Friday night. It's going to be a lot of fun. I hope each and every one of you will be here. This is an incredibly busy week in the life of our church. Today, the children's musical practices start at 2 o'clock, so that's important. On tomorrow night, we'll have our community meal. And then Tuesday night, our property team, our property improvement team is meeting for the last time, and they will present all that at the church council this coming weekend, this coming Sunday night. Then Friday night, we have the Isaacs. And then next Sunday, we'll have church council for all of our leaders at 5 o'clock and a church business meeting at 6:30, where we will hear about the property improvement team. We'll make a presentation that night. And we have a very interesting and exciting opportunity with the Chesterfield County Food Bank, with using our gym twice a month to feed folks in this neighborhood. So like 200 folks, 200 families every other Friday night. So those are some opportunities that are coming our way and stuff to think about this week. On Wednesday night, Awana's kicks off. And we want you to come, bring your little ones. Of course, we have adult Bible studies for men and women, and lots of fun stuff going on Wednesday nights at 6:30, starting this Wednesday night. Our commander has notified me we still need a third grade girls leader and a kindergarten helper. So please think about if what you're doing on Wednesday night, we could use a little more help with Awana. And I know our bus driver could use some help too. So we want to pick up a lot of kids from our neighborhood and bring them in and lead them to Jesus. So we got a lot going on this week, don't we? Right now, we want to continue worshiping the Lord. Would you stand with me? Lord Jesus, we love you and we need you. And we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't know what's going to happen the rest of the day. But we do know that you are in complete control. And we praise you for that. We trust you for that. Can't do anything without you. And Lord, I just pray that you would anoint our service today. I pray that you'd anoint this music as we sing praises to your name, that we would truly and sincerely worship you because you're worthy of it. And I pray for those that are hurting, that need a fresh touch, that you would do that. Lord, I pray for the one who may not yet know you, that today that person will come to Christ. And I pray that each one of us could walk out of here knowing that we were in the presence of God Almighty, and that you changed us, and that you healed us, and that you comforted us, and that you even convicted our hearts and changed us. We pray all these things in the mighty name of Jesus, our Savior.
Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could have walked through. When you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know, I'm
everybody. Let's pray real quick. Lord, thank you so much for everything you do for us in our everyday lives, Lord. You're always there and you're always present for us. And I know one thing we can do is give the little bit that we have to you, and you can exemplify that, Lord. You can make that for your kingdom and just bring people closer to you through our offerings. And Lord, we love you, and every day we're here today. We are blessed today just for being here and being able to worship you. And Lord, just thank you for all that you do. And we're just so grateful. And Lord, just bless these offerings. Bless this church. Bless our church family, Lord. And thank you again for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We dismissing our children to Kids Zone now? Yes? Kids are dismissed to Kids Zone. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, our King. His name is wonderful. His name is worthy to be praised. He is so good to us. He's been so good to me. I want to say thank you to every one of you that have sent cards and texts and emails and calls and everything, checking in on me over the last couple weeks. It really is appreciated. My family and I want to say thank you, and for meals and food and everything. Just truly, truly appreciate it. Every one of you for being so kind to us. And it's good to be back up here today. I'll be honest with you, last Sunday I came to church, wasn't feeling great. Not feeling great today. But as Pastor Justin was preaching, he's on vacation, so don't tell him this when he gets back. But as he was preaching, I really felt the Lord was giving me a message for today. As I was sitting here listening to him preach, it reminded me of going to church when I was in seminary and Bible college, how often I'd write down little titles and little notes of things I wanted to preach one day. And now I get to do that. So I want to ask you a question to start off with this morning, and that question is very somber. It's very direct. If you died today, would you have any regrets? When you look back at your life, are there things you'd regret? Do you have a bucket list that you haven't quite finished, checked everything off? I can tell you, I'm with 9 people more than I'd like to admit. And I'm talking scores and scores of people that I've been with that were dying. Very rarely do they ever bring out a bucket list or talk about things they've, you know, sometimes they might, but I've not had one yet pull out a bucket list with things that weren't crossed off that they were mad about not getting to. What matters most to you when you think about if your life ended today? Most people don't know that their life is going to end. Some people do, but most people don't. Would you regret? Is there something you would look back on with regret and think, man, I wish I'd done that. I wish I'd talked to that person. I wish I'd tried that thing. I wish I'd gone to that place. I wish I'd lived a little bit differently. Now, young people, when you think about it, there will come a time if you live to be elderly and you don't want to make decisions now that you'll regret. Of course, most of us have made exactly those kind of choices and decisions that we look back with regret. But someday, And again, I was faced just recently with being in the position of being in a really violent car accident and knocked out and concussion and ribs and some vertebrae in my back were cracked. And I was just totally out of it and totally, I didn't know what was going to happen. I was kind of in another world while all that was going on. And honestly, the Lord gave me incredible peace. My daughter was in the car. She was asking me questions, so I knew she was okay. She was asking me how I was doing, asking me if I was okay, and I said, no, I am not okay. That was my answer. They tell me. I don't really remember saying that, but maybe a little bit. But the Lord took care of us. The Lord protected us. She's bumped and bruised and whiplash and all that, but she's okay, and I'm on the mend now. But it really did make me stop and think, what if I died? You know, what if the Sunday before last, and David Rodenizer was here the week before that, so 3 weeks ago I preached at Kingsland. What if that was the last chance I ever had to preach at Kingsland? And I was never going to have another chance to do that. What would I want to say? I mean, what would it be about? What would be my parting words? I've always thought if I knew I was going to die, I'd want to make a video to play at my funeral. I don't know why more people don't do that. I would want to, you know, crack a few jokes and say some things that were on my heart. But it did, this recent series of events I've been through had made me pause to think, you know, what someday is going to be my last sermon. What would I say? Someday is going to be my last opportunity. What would I do? Had a guy in high school that I did not know, and he does not know me. I know his name. I'm sure he knew mine. He was he's a druggie. He was not great guy to hang out with. I don't ever remember talking to him. I don't ever remember having a conversation with him. And he sure didn't have anything to say to me. We had some mutual friends. But found out this week that he died. And from everything I'm reading, it seems pretty obvious he took his own life. And that really hurt to think about. This guy I never spoke to. I could tell you his name. I'm not going to say his name. I could tell you his name. Everybody knew him. It wasn't a huge school. We probably had 1,200, 1,300 kids in my high school. Most of us knew each other. He's gone. And it was such a hollow and sad feeling learning of that. And then I realized he either on purpose or on accident killed himself 2 years ago at Christmas. He's been gone for years. I didn't know. We're not close. We didn't keep up with each other or anything. I'm not 100% sure he even knew who I was, to be honest with you. I knew who he was. And I knew he had problems. I knew he was way off. And you know what? Even as a kid, I knew that's somebody I should talk to about the Lord. I never did. To be honest with you, we never had a conversation. I don't think we ever spoke a word to one another. But he's gone. The opportunity to even try. Now, admittedly, as an adult man, it's a little bit difficult to go back and try to reach people from high school. Guys, you need to do that now while you're in high school, while they actually want to hear from you and they don't think you're weird hunting them down 20 years later. But it made me so sad to think that this guy who, you know, had a bad upbringing, bad set of circumstances, he's gone. He's in eternity. The Bible tells us there's a real heaven and a real hell. Every single one of us will spend eternity in one of those two places. And he's in one of those two places today. And I don't know if anybody ever talked to him about the Lord. I didn't. And that bothers me. It should bother you when you think about the people in your life that you've known, that you could have, that you should have, that you would have if the right set of circumstances. Quit waiting for the right, perfect set of circumstances. Just do what you need to do. And when I ask that question directly, what if you died today? We used to ask this all the time, and when we were more aggressive in our soul-winning tactics, what if you died today? Do you know that you're going to heaven? If you're not 100% sure, why? Why not be? You can be 100% sure that you're on your way to heaven. You need to be. I want you to be 100% sure you're on your way to heaven. And that's only possible through a relationship with Jesus Christ, the one whose beautiful name we praise. He's so awesome, he's so lovely, he's so merciful, and we praise him because he saved us. If he's not yet saved you, I encourage you, just cry out to him for salvation. Believe in what he did on the cross for you. He shed his blood for you. He was buried. He rose from the grave. He did everything necessary to save your soul. And all you need to do is receive it. Accept it. And the truth is, each and every one of us will come to that point in our lives. I hope it's not through a traumatic car accident. I hope you live to be 90 or 100. But each and every one of us will come to that point where we will say goodbye to this world. And what I'm trying to say today is, number one, you need to be ready for that personally. But number two, there are some things that as long as God gives me breath, as long as God gives you breath, I would like to see our church consumed with certain things. And it's not the status of the carpet, although hopefully we're going to fix that here pretty soon. But that's not what I want to see our church consumed with, or stained glass windows. I had a preacher buddy that took a church out in the country that had hundreds of thousands of dollars tied into their stained glass windows, a very poor community with hungry people. And they had to make a huge decision to fix up their glass windows or to make another change. And they decided to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on their stained glass windows. And of course, this guy's not there anymore. He was sickened by that. So we're not so much worried about things that don't matter. We need to consume ourselves. We need to really invest our lives into that which really does matter. So I thought about it. My prayer for Kingsland Baptist Church is that God would give us a passion, that God would give me and you an insatiable appetite, a desire. We talked about in class this morning, we talked about giving up smoking. If you've ever been I've never been addicted to cigarettes, but that's a hard thing to give up. Sweet tea would be that for me. You know, it's hard to give up sweet tea. If you got a taste for it, it's an appetite that you've acquired over time. And some of us have some appetites for some really bad things that are unhealthy for us, even wicked things that are immoral and maybe even illegal. What if we had an insatiable appetite for the things that really matter? A consuming, all-consuming desire. And when I was sitting over there the other day, listening to Pastor Justin preach, but also thinking, and the Lord was speaking in my heart, that there's some things that really, really matter that we need to never lose sight of. And by the way, we'll be back in 1 Timothy real soon. I've had my sermon prepared for that for weeks. I could have preached that this morning, and I will soon. But I really wanted to talk about this today. So here's my prayer for Kingsland Baptist Church, that God will give you, when I say you, I'm not talking about you collectively, you collectively, but you, Patrick, John, Haley, you, not just those, everybody, don't say that loud, but your name, you, a insatiable desire, an appetite, first of all, for the Word of God. For the Word of God. Psalm 119:105 says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." Verse 11 says, "Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might sin against God." That's why we want our kids memorizing these verses. We want our kids knowing the Word of God. We want our kids reading and rehearsing the Word of God. In a few weeks, we'll get to 2 Timothy 3:16. This is actually probably a few months going through our study on Timothy. It'll be a while before we get there, but it'll tell us that all Scripture is breathed out by God. It's inspired. It's breathed out by God Himself. He spoke it. It's inerrant. It's infallible. It's inspired. So, most of you probably believe that already. Most of you came into the building thinking, yeah, I believe that. John 1, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. And then a few verses later in verse 11, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we're going to celebrate Christmas. The kids are doing Christmas musical practice this afternoon. It's literally right around the corner. Everything in our society revolves around Christmas. Thank God we still live in a society that celebrates Christmas. Jesus, the Word of God, became flesh. You're holding something supernatural in your hands here. We need to read it, memorize it, live it, make much of it, build our lives around it. Ask Drew Brees, quarterback Drew Brees, how that's going for him this week. All he did, so let's put this in our context of where we are. All he did was film a video for Focus on the Family saying, hey, kids, take your Bibles to school. And I would say that, guys, take your Bible to school. Get you a little New Testament, take it to school. It's a good idea. He didn't say anything controversial. He didn't do anything controversial. He's just a good Christian guy. He's a quarterback, one of the most beloved figures in the whole NFL. And the world, the media, the left, the radical LGBT people have completely attacked him and completely trying to destroy his name and his reputation for the sin, for the crime of joining hands with Focus on the Family, an organization I've been listening to my whole life. And we're doing their truth project with the men right now. We used some of their marriage family project this summer. Good people, not radical haters, not bigots, but people who believe the Word of God. Do you understand that if you believe the Word of God, I'm not talking about, oh, I'm a Christian, whatever that means in our society, or I'm a religious, whatever. I mean, I believe the Bible. I want you to believe the Bible. I want you to be consumed with it. Pick it up, read it, memorize it, pray it, talk about it, and actually take a strong stand for what it says on stuff. And I hope Drew Brees will continue to do that. I can remember my very first Bible. Can you remember your very first Bible? Anybody like that? You can remember your very first Bible. Mine was red, like a dark burgundy. It had lots of pictures in it, and it had little clarification notes and stuff. I've always loved that Bible. And then I loved it so much, I lost it. I was only like 9. I lost the thing. It's probably, you know, $20 or $30 Bible. And I was so sad. I'm still sad. I would have loved to have had that Bible on my shelf somewhere. I loved the Bible from the time I was a little kid. I loved reading the Bible. I couldn't have imagined a time in my world, in the United States of America, where to believe the Bible made you a bigoted hate monger. But you know what? That's real close to where we're getting. Pretty close to persecution, and certainly close to annoyance. If you don't believe me, just take your Bible to work and start reading some controversial passages really loud. See how that goes for you. I'm not saying you should do that. But I am saying that we should have a burning desire to know the Word of God, to share the Word of God with our kids, to build our lives on the Word of God, come what may, whatever anybody thinks about it, whatever anybody has to say about it. The question this morning is, what is more important to you than the Word of God? Think about it. You might read Time Magazine. You might read People Magazine. You might read your websites, your Facebook, your Instagram, your cable television, your sports channels. Think about your time. Think about the way you're investing your day. What is the most important? And then think about the way you make your decisions about your values and so forth. What is more important to you, the Word of God or the word of a professor, the word of MTV, the way they feel about it, a situation or a circumstance, the word of whatever, some other person? What's more important to you? It needs to be the Word of God. And what I'm trying to say is that when I was sitting in church last week, hearing someone just preach and teach from the Word of God, it occurred to me that we could go to church most weeks. We could go to church here. We could have religious ceremonies. I mean, in your class this morning, you could tell jokes. You could tell stories. You could talk about life. You could do just a... Do you realize there's churches that don't ever open up the Bible? Not going to happen here. We're not going to tolerate that here. If that's happening anywhere in anything we're doing, it needs to go. We need to get back right here. This is what is true. This is what is infallible. Not my opinions, not our teachers' opinions. Thus saith the Lord. And if we don't teach our kids to really value this thing and to be willing to die for it, man, we're in trouble. Now, that might be a little uncomfortable. It's certainly inconvenient, even for a superstar quarterback. But I pray to God that somebody like him or like you or like me will just say, look, we love everybody. We're not hating anybody. We accept everybody. We're not mad at anybody, but we believe the Word of God, and this is the way you should live your life. I talked to a pastor last night on the phone who's further along in his ministry than me, much further. 65 used to seem really old to me. Now I'm 20 years from that, and I'm like, well, that's not really that old. But this guy's 65 years old, but he's talking about a situation where he was going to baptize a guy in his church, and the children and the guy. But it turned out this dude's living with his girlfriend, and he wanted to have a little more conversation with the guy before he jumped into making them a member of their church and immediately having to perform church discipline on them, because you can't be a member of the church when you're living in open flagrant sin. And you know what? He did. Lovingly, kindly, graciously. I was like, well, how did it feel when the guy busted you upside the head? No, I didn't say that, but the guy actually took it quite well. And it turns out his girlfriend, his fiance, is like, yeah, I want to get married. Let's get it done. You know, she's happy that the preacher put pressure on the guy to go ahead and tie the knot. But are we willing to stand up when it's inconvenient and to just speak and teach and live the truth? Don't we owe that to our children? Don't we owe that to everybody here to just say, hey, this is what the Bible says. Don't get mad at me. We're going to be nice about it. We're going to be loving about it. We're not going to shove it in anybody's face. But the Word of God is authoritative. Way more important than your opinion about it, or mine, or anybody else's. It's the Word of God. It is. So what I'm saying is, you may get an illness and know you're going to die, or you may, like in my situation, you might just, I never saw it coming. I never saw this person. They ran a red light. They ran into me, knocked me into La La Land. I mean, it was awful, and I never knew it even happened, really. I mean, I didn't know what was happening. And whenever I say goodbye, and I don't know when that's going to be, I just want to know, now, there's so many things I can't change, and some of you probably feel this way. It's like, man, I've done some things I'm embarrassed about. I understand. I really do. I believe me when I tell you I do. But you can't change those things other than just ask the Lord to forgive you and save you and put it under the blood, and He will. But at the same time, I'm not a grandparent yet. I was with my brother yesterday, who is now a grandparent, so I'm a great uncle, spending time with my little great nieces. But there's some things I want to tell them unapologetically, graciously. This is what it is. This is the truth. I want my children to know the truth. And yeah, there's a whole lot of things I could have done better and wish I'd done differently, even as a pastor. I'm not making any excuses for that. I'm really not. I'm just saying these are things that absolutely, before I say goodbye to this world, I want to make sure everybody knows this was worth living for. This was worth dying for. This was worth battling in a very sweet and kind and gracious way, because we all have neighbors. We all have friends and loved ones that are going through all kinds of stuff. They don't need us looking down on them and pointing fingers at them. They need us to love them. But don't they need us to love them enough to tell them the truth about what this book says about their life? Justin's granddad died this weekend. Pray for Justin Haga. I didn't know him, but I know a little bit about him. He's in heaven this morning. And again, that seems so far away, especially for our younger folks. It could be today. It could literally be today. Are you ready? Are you saved? And have you built your life on the Word of God? And whatever you have left of your life, I recommend you, I challenge you, I'm begging you, build it on the Word of God, get into the Word of God, open this thing up and read it, be nice about it, don't be the jerk at work, don't be the ugly person that is always coming up with a little smart comment every time somebody's not quite doing it. Get your life together, lovingly help other people, and give them the Word of God. So what are you going to consume your life with? The Word of God. Secondly, the worship of God. The worship of God. Turn over to Psalm 34. And I've been reading Psalm 34. I've been praying Psalm 34 over and over and over. Psalm 34. Let's all go there. Everybody, turn to Psalm 34. Don't take my word for it. I could be reading the Reader's Digest or something. Let's look at the Word of God. We just talked about the Bible. Word of God, Psalm 34, gives us 10 ways to worship the Lord, 10 ways to praise. You know, when I was a kid, I mean, music's been a big part of my life. I was an Elvis guy. Anybody else Elvis people? Yeah. Barbara Harper, Henry and Barbara. Oh, my goodness. She saw Elvis when she was a little girl. Don't ever talk bad about Elvis to Mrs. Harper. So that was my whole thing. And maybe a little Barry Manilow and Jim Croce, or I don't know, whatever, in the 70s, John Denver. But I remember getting into high school, and that I sort of transitioned more into like Paula Abdul and Guns N' Roses, you know. But as a young man, that's very different there, two very different genres. But as a young man, I came down to Richmond, Virginia in October of 1992, and God changed my life right here in this city. I never came to Richmond except for King's Dominion. But I can remember as a little boy driving through Virginia and smelling the tobacco when you went past Philip Morris. I can remember there was tolls there years ago. I was a little kid. I wasn't from here, but as a young man, I came to Richmond, Virginia to see Steve and Curtis Chapman in concert, and it changed my life. God changed my life. My brother was with me, changed his life too. God just did he became my favorite singer for years, my whole adult life, Steve and Curtis Chapman. If you don't have any of his music, get it. It's awesome. And Third Day and Casting Crowns and stuff like that. But I got to be honest with you. When it comes to worship, first of all, when we read this text on worship, there's something you need to notice. You will know. Maybe you'll notice. I'll tell you ahead of time in case you don't. It doesn't say anything about singing. Of course, when we think of worship, we think about music, right? Singing. And today, when it comes to singing, and this is the Lord knows I'm telling you the truth, because I listen to stuff on the radio, I listen to stuff on my phone. Do you know my favorite music in the whole world? My favorite music. Now, I like the Isaacs. They're great. Singing that Alison Krauss song. She's great. But that's still not my favorite music. My favorite music today is to put in the Sunday worship service from our church and to listen to our band or to just be here singing. I love just worship music. I love worshiping here. This is my favorite place to be. I would rather worship here. Now, there's a lot of fun, exciting things you can do in life. I would just as soon be right here worshiping. I love worshiping, singing these songs, a lot of new songs, some old songs, but man, we just worship the Lord. And I hope that you will develop a passion for worship. If you have a passion for the Word of God, you will naturally have a passion for the lovely, beautiful Savior. And look at Psalm 34. It gives you 10 ways to praise. We'll do them quick. Just underline them. You don't have to write them all down. You can just underline them in your Bible. Psalm 34, I will bless, is underlined. That's number one, the Lord at all times. His praise, number two, shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble be glad, hear and be glad. In other words, when you boast about yourself, that's pride, that's bad. But when you're bragging about Jesus, that's a good thing. That's a way to worship the Lord. Look at verse 3. We have our fourth one. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. And if you're reading it, read it out loud with me, would you? Oh, magnify the Lord with me together, and let us exalt his name together. Let's say that last part together. And let us exalt his name together. That's what we've been doing this morning, even in Bible study with prayer and studying the word. But singing, we're exalting the name of the Lord together. And I would submit to you, there's a whole lot of dead Baptist churches out there all over our country who are quote unquote exalting and praising the Lord together. And it's just dead. And not just Baptists, man, throw in the Methodists and a bunch of others too. I mean, just pick on us. There's a lot of churches that are supposedly having a worship service right now, and nothing like that is actually happening. People just going through the motions, people that are consumed with their own stuff. Believe me, I can tell you, I've been consumed with my own stuff lately. When you're hurting, when you're in physical pain, you tend to be concerned with your own stuff. I truly feel your pain on that one. But it says, let us exalt his name together. There's something special about Sunday. This is the Lord's day, and yet, more than 50% of the Southern Baptist Church rolls, including Kingsland's, the people that are members of that church do not go to church on Sunday. That's pathetic. We are to exalt the name of the Lord together. That's church. That's what we're here to do today, to worship the Lord together as a church. Verse 4, I sought the Lord. That's how you worship the Lord. Seek after him. Seek him. And he answered me, delivered me. Verse 6, this poor man cried, and the Lord healed him and saved him. When's the last time you just cried out to the Lord for a loved one, someone that you love so much that's lost, or a neighbor? When's the last time you cried over the deadness of the typical church, even our church sometimes? Cried over the condition of our country. Verse 7, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Fear of God. Did you know that you worship the Lord by fearing him, by revering him, by showing reverence and fear and awe? holy awe for how great and powerful and awesome he is. A couple more. Verse 8, oh, taste and see. That's very physical language there. Those metaphors are strong. Taste and see. Taste and see that the Lord is good. And then lastly, verse 11, come, O children, listen to me. You've heard it said, God gave us two ears and one mouth for a reason. Listen, listen. We worship the Lord by listening. Those are 10 ways to praise the Lord. I hope you underline them. I hope you'll use it. And the results, very quickly, the results are in verse 2, gladness. I want some of that. In verse 4, answered prayer. He will hear you and answer you. It goes on in verse 4 to talk about deliverance, and in verse 6. And then in verse 7, the angel of the Lord will encamp you. He will be with you. Another result in verse 8, his blessings. In verse 9, his provision. In verse 18, his presence. In verse 22, redemption. Oh man, how good is that? And a full pardon. Listen, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. That's worth coming to church to hear. If you're if you feel under the curse, if you feel like a failure, if you feel like you're condemned, if you feel like God's constantly looking down on you and so are other people, stop it. You've been given a full pardon. The Lord, in verse 22, redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. And here's one I really like, confidence. That's the 10th thing he'll give you, confidence, boldness, courage. That's in verse 4. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Man, that's a good promise. That's good stuff, isn't it? Worship him. You don't know that this might be the last chance you have to worship the Lord. I didn't know that the other day. I wasn't thinking about that. I don't think about that very often. Someday is going to be your last chance to worship the Lord. I would say approach every Sunday that way. One reason I feel like I may be a few pounds overweight is because I approach every meal as if it were going to be my last. And that's a problem. I mean, we ate so much food yesterday, I don't know what is wrong with me. With family and just get to go and... What if we worship the Lord every Sunday as if it was going to be our last? Your last opportunity to sing and shout and praise and jump and dance and holler and kneel and bless and lift holy hands and just worship the God who saved you. I'm telling you, we need revival. Someone prayed for that at our last little Wednesday night prayer meeting this summer. The Lord would bring revival to our church. I'm telling you, as kindly and straightforward as possible, this land needs revival. And the church needs revival. Kingsland Baptist Church needs revival. And it needs to be revival of the Word of God. Not some fancy preacher, some great orator that makes you feel good, makes you, you know, really just delivers these eloquent sermons. You don't need any more eloquent sermons. It's nice. I mean, boring isn't fun either. I'm with you. What you need to do is to be captivated, enamored with the Word of God. And even if we disagree on a part, even if we disagree, I'm not saying on whether or not it's true or infallible. It is true. It is infallible. But you might read something and go, well, gee, I think it means this. And I might say, well, I think it means that. I would rather have that happen once in a while than have spiritual and scriptural deadness where there's no discussion of any of it because you don't care. I'm telling you, we need to have a passion for the Word of God and the worship of God, and they go to hand in hand. If you have a love for the Word of God, you have a love for Jesus, you're going to worship Him. And if you want to worship Him, man, we're not looking for blind emotionalism and hooping and hollering and acting silly and running around with no scriptural depth. We want scriptural depth. But my goodness, if all you have is head knowledge and no emotional, worshipful spirit, you're missing something. And vice versa. If you're all excited about it and you have no spiritual wisdom, you're missing something, right? These two things go hand in hand. Number three, got to wrap this thing up. Number three, a passion, a love for the work of God. And that's what I'm praying for you. That's what I'm praying for me, that God will revive my love and my passion for the Word of God, the worship of God, and the work of God. And yeah, they go hand in hand, don't they? What Psalm 100 said, serve the Lord with gladness. You can do that. I can do that. You can serve the Lord with gladness. I've been reading in Nehemiah in my personal Bible reading. And I got to be honest with you, I got hit on the head pretty hard the other day. I'll be reading the Bible and just fall asleep lately. Of course, I was doing that some before, honestly. I'm tired. I don't know. Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 6 says, the people had a mind to work. You see, Nehemiah and his escapees, his folks, were allowed to come back. They were in captivity, but they were allowed to come back to Jerusalem and told they could build that wall around Jerusalem. And said that God's hand was on them. God defended them. They had a shovel in one hand and a spear in the other because they were being attacked by the enemy as they're trying to build the wall. They rebuilt that wall in 52 days, all the way around Jerusalem, old Jerusalem, smaller Jerusalem, but still quite a feat, because they had a mind to work. Do you? Do we? I'm not asking you to do five jobs, or some of you are doing three or four jobs, and you probably need to let some go, honestly. I'm asking you, are you willing to do one or two things around here that need to be done? I'm praying that God will give us a passion for the work of the Lord. Sorry. That we will have a mind to work. Romans 12, chapter 1 says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. That's the King James. The newer translation says your spiritual act of worship. Worship and service go hand in hand. A love for the Word of God, a love for the worship of God, and a love for the work of God. It's all together. If you love Him, you're going to serve Him. If you're not serving the Lord, don't deceive yourself into thinking you love Him. You do not. You probably don't even know Him. And if you're not worshiping Him, why? Cold, dead, apathetic offerings, they don't mean a whole lot, do they? We worship Him. We give our tithes. That's a sacrifice. That's a big sacrifice. Had an interesting thing happen the other day. Had a missionary visit me, and a friend from high school. Haven't seen him since high school. Haven't seen him since middle school. He's a missionary to Brazil. He stopped by my office, and I got a chance to spend some time with him. He's just spent his whole life serving Jesus. He's a little younger than me. He's 41, and he spent his whole life. He learned Portuguese. He's in Brazil. He has a church. He's just doing all these great things, and he just knew where I was, and he wanted to reconnect, and we talked, and all he does is just serve the Lord. He's not perfect. He knows I'm not. But it was so encouraging to see someone who served the Lord. And an interesting little thing happened. I gave him a gift card. I'd been given a gift card. And I had somewhere I had to be. I couldn't go with him. And I said, here, take this gift card. Go get lunch. I wish I could go with you, but I can't. And when I went home, I told my wife that I gave him that gift card to that place she wanted to go to. And I actually liked it a lot, but you know what's really weird? The next day, when I came home from work, Elizabeth said, oh, by the way, we just got a letter with an envelope with a gift card to that same place for twice as much as the original gift card was. I was like, well, we should give it away. And maybe tomorrow we'll get a gift card for like $800, you know. You just can't outgive God. All this stuff goes together. When you sacrifice financially, listen, the Lord knows it's a sacrifice. The Lord knows you could go buy some new thing with that. But it's an act of worship and an act of service. They go hand in hand. And that leads into the last thing I want to say today, and that is, this is more of an overarching point, that we would just have a passion for the will of God as adults and teenagers. The Word of God, the worship of God, the work of God, and the will of God. Turn over to Psalm 143, and this will be the last thing we look at. I want you to be consumed with these things. When I was talking to that older pastor yesterday, even the younger pastor last week, I realized God is using him greatly where he is, but he has no idea where he's going to be a few years from now. He has no idea what the political situation in Brazil is going to be, or where we're going to be, or his visa, or any of that stuff. I have no idea where I'm going to be 5 years from now. I really don't. I don't know what God's going to do with me 5 years from now. This older pastor I was talking to recently, last night, He doesn't know. He's getting older, and he's got all these assignments. He's telling me all the things he's doing. I'm like, man, that's pretty tough. And he said, yeah, I'm not sure that I'm going to be able to do all this stuff when I'm 70. I said, yeah, I don't know if I could do it now. But that older pastor and that younger missionary and me and you and the younger people and the older people, we need to have a heartbeat that says, Lord, show me your will. That's what this week is about in our church, by the way. What is God's will? Next Sunday night, all of our new workers for the next year will be presented. Next Sunday night, a plan to totally rechange signage and interior and here and all kinds of stuff is going to be presented. This week, we're gonna really, really make hard decisions about what to do about feeding our community. We're already feeding our community. Do you want to go to a whole other level? These are big decisions that will affect the vision in the future of our church. And I think we need to pray, and I'm telling you, we need to pray, not my will be done, but yours, Lord. Show me what you want me to do. The will of God. So Psalm 143 is one of my favorite chapters in all the Psalms. Psalms are my very favorite, and this is one of my very favorite Psalms. Look at verse 8. It says, let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love, for in you I trust. Now, that gives you an idea of when you should be reading your Bible, doesn't it? You need to start the day with the Word of God. Now, I do. I do that regularly. Sometimes I have a hard time ending my day with the Word of God. I think you should do that too. I need to do more of that. A little more of that and a little less whatever. But let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love, for in you do I trust. Make me to know the way I should go, for to you I lift up my soul. Is that your prayer this morning? Are you willing to do whatever God says? What if God said, sell your house and move to Africa? Be a missionary. What if God said, put your kids out of that learning environment and put them in that learning environment? And what if God said, oh, by the way, that your child that was studying to go and to be this great wealthy professional, whatever, he or she is going to go to Cambodia as a missionary. See, we talked about Romans 12 a minute ago. It goes on to say, don't be conformed to this world, this world's value system, the things this world elevates and thinks so much of. For instance, on Sunday afternoon, on the first day of the NFL today, and with college really getting reared up these last two weekends, are you more conformed and concerned about that than you are the Word of God, worshiping God, and working for God? I'm not saying those things are bad. I'm just saying we should be 1 million times more concerned about the things of the Lord. We don't want to be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God, which takes us to this last point, the will of God. Are you still there in Psalm 143? Look at verse 10. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. I would say, teenagers, you need to make these some of the verses of your life. But so do we as adults. So do we as retired, or wherever you may be. Single mom, single dad, whatever. Make the will of God your burning, consuming passion. I hold in my hand a sticky note. Today I've actually been preaching off multiple sticky notes. I don't usually do that, but once in a while I get all fired up. Write things on sticky notes. Thank God for Lisa. She, our secretary, administrative secretary, put it all on PowerPoint for us, so she did a great job with that. Don't usually give her sticky notes, but I did this week. This is my sticky note from Tuesday, August 27th. Staff meeting. It went swimmingly. I don't remember any of it, but it was good. And then I had a meeting with a dear, sweet senior after that. And then I went and visited Renee Burrow. Dee's still here. She was in Sunday school. Where did Dee go? Maybe she left. She was in Sunday school. Visited her mom. We had a sweet, sweet time together. And then I had a meeting about my middle school basketball team I'm coaching, which went well. At 6:30, August 27th. And then there was a blank spot after that that I filled in the other day. It's in, everything else is in black, but I filled this one in blue. 8:30, crash. I'm going to hold on to this sticky note as a little reminder of what that day was all about. I wasn't planning on having my life completely changed. And the truth is, other than a whole lot of pain and suffering over the last few weeks and losing a sweet little car that ain't worth a whole lot, but I'm okay, I guess. Could have been a lot worse. Thank God my daughter's okay. None of us write on a sticky note. None of us put on our to-do list, meeting, meeting, die at the end, because we don't know. But the Bible says it is appointed unto a man once to die, and after this the judgment. For sinners, for lost people, that's the white throne judgment, where the last thing you'll hear is, depart from me, I never knew you, and you'll be thrown into hell forever. That's a very unpopular and not very happy message. It is 100% true, and it applies to every single person you and I know that does not know Jesus. You need to think about that. But as believers, we'll stand before the Bema judgment, the judgment seat of Christ, and we'll give an account for our lives and be rewarded for the good things we did. And then we'll take those crowns and we'll lay them down at the feet of Jesus. I don't know when my appointment is. Thank God it wasn't on August 27th. I'm really thrilled about that. I'm really happy that it wasn't. But I don't know when it is. Neither do you. My suggestion, my challenge, my admonition to you is to consume your life, not with television, not with sports, not with hobbies, not with junk. And a lot of those things are actually pretty cool compared to drugs, alcohol, and you know, awful crime and gang membership. Okay, those are bad. Don't do that. But most of you aren't with the Bloods or the Crips. Okay? Most of you are just good, decent people that pay your taxes and go to work and live your lives, and we all have to do that. What I'm saying today is, and I'm asking you, are you truly consumed with the Word of God or not? And all you got to do is look over your last 168 hours since you were here listening to Pastor Justin last week. How much time did you spend in this thing? That's the answer. You can change that this week. When we were worshiping earlier, was it just something to get through, or were you just passionately just closing your eyes and singing out to Jesus? We're going to have another opportunity to worship right now. Ask the band to come back. Let's worship the Lord the way He's worthy of being praised and honored. And as far as working for God, let's be real clear. Nobody ever worked their way to heaven. You can't even work your way to pleasing God. It's your faith that pleases God. But when you are in a relationship with Jesus, the Word of God, and you're worshiping the Lord, you're going to want to serve Him somehow. And thankfully, there's so many of you that can do things I can't do. I cannot fix your car. Sorry, I know guys who can. I'm not really good with landscaping, mostly because it's just a pain, but I can do a little. I know some people that are amazing at it. There's some things I'm pretty good at. There's some things I'm not so good at. I'm so thankful for all the people that God has brought this body that can be used to do different things. Are you consumed with God's will for your life, or are you more concerned about your agenda for your life? I don't know what crazy or difficult or uncomfortable thing He may ask of you. I can almost guarantee you, before we sing, I hate pain. August was one of the most painful months of my life, and I don't want to go back. I am a big sissy. I do not like suffering or pain or inconvenience at all. Okay? Hate it. Very impatient. The Lord's working with me on that, evidently. But, are we going to live our lives like, to some extent, you know, you don't want to buy a motorcycle and drive up and down the road 100 miles an hour without a helmet on. I'm not talking about craziness. You should buckle up. That's, you know, reasonable things. But are we going to live our lives consumed with comfort? It has to be 72.5 degrees all the time. Consumed with our own happiness. And never taking the chance of hurting, almost like just wrapping ourselves in bubble wrap and just sort of slowly walking through life, praying nobody bumps into us. I can't live that way. I'm not going to live that way. I want to live by faith. I want to trust the one who has my appointment in His book. It's already said. I can't do a whole lot about it. I'm not going to live recklessly, but I know God's got it under control. And not so much worry about my own comfort and my own avoiding pain at all costs or inconvenience, and to say, forget that. I'm crucified with Christ. That sounds painful, doesn't it? Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. In the life I now live, in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. That's a life worth living. And I really believe some of you have lived that way. Some of you are closer than others of us. And you're going to say goodbye to this world 5, 10, I don't know how many years from now, without a whole lot of regrets. I don't want to have a bunch of regrets. I don't want you to either. I want to live up to everything God's given me, accomplish everything He's assigned for me to accomplish, and do everything He's appointed for me to do. And to see him face to face and to say, you know, I've spent my life based on this book, not what was popular. I spent my life worshiping when it was inconvenient or when it was convenient. And that work, that's what Elizabeth's dad loves to say. It will get done by doing. That's his quote. There's no walls in this church that are going to get painted unless someone picks up a paintbrush and does it. Just good old-fashioned work. That's okay. And to consume yourself with the will of God. Would you stand with me? Lord, I pray that you would bless our time of invitation where we have been forced to reckon with these things. And some of us are convicted because of our lack of Bible time. I pray, Lord God, that people would make a change, make a decision right now. Or half-hearted worship. Lord, as we sing this ancient, amazing, awesome song, that we will just sing of your love and grace with all of our heart, soul, and mind. And that we'll take Psalm 34 and apply it to our lives, each and every one of those 10 areas, that we will praise you. And then we'll find a job that needs to be done and get to work. The one you lead us to. The one it's your perfect will for us to do. And Lord, I pray that if anybody needs to be saved, that they just come and receive your free gift of salvation at this time. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's sing.
Unending.
shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. And God who called me here below will be
us online or on Comcast Xfinity this week. We hope you enjoyed the service. We at Kingsland exist to connect people with Christ. That's our mission. That's what we exist to do. And we want to get you connected with Christ. And we want you to join us on Sunday morning if you are able at 11 a.m. We have Bible studies at 9:30, service at 11 o'clock at 8801 Perrymont Road. Please feel free to contact us throughout the week, and you can do that by phone number 275-1285, or you can contact the church office at office@kingslandbaptist.com, and we would be happy to get you connected with Christ. During the service, you might have made a decision to be connected with Christ, and we'd love to hear about that, and we'd love to be able to share more with you what it means to follow Christ as Christ came and he lived a life that we couldn't live, making it possible for us to be connected with him as he died on the cross for our sins, was buried, rose again 3 days later, defeating death. And if you put your faith and trust in Christ and you turn from your sins, Scripture tells us that you will be saved. So we hope that you join us here in the coming weeks, and we'd love to see you.
I wanna be close to you. I wanna be close to you. There's nothing in this world that compares to all you are. In the arms of the Father, there is love like no other. He who formed all things Master.